Taylor is driving, so we'll have a special time of prayer for that. And they will be back this afternoon, and our students will leave first thing in the morning for Centrifuge Camp in Tennessee. So we're really excited about what God is doing in the hearts and minds of our children and also our students. So you can be continuing to pray for what has happened at Kids Camp and be praying our students out as they leave first thing in the morning. Tonight at 5 o'clock, we do have our prayer and praise service. That is a great time for everybody to get to not only sing songs of praise together, not only pray together, but also get to hear from someone, from some of our folks who went to Guatemala, and get to hear about what God did on that mission trip as well. We're heading into August. I know it's a little crazy to be talking about August when we just started July. In August, right there at the beginning, August 2nd, we will have our foster night out. So if you are interested in helping with that, you can either sign up on our church website or you can email me at trey@fpcdothan.org. And so we have a lot of great things happening. We are in the hottest part of the summer, but we are so happy to get to worship together. And so with that being said, let's have our call to worship.
Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm chapter 103, and it's a psalm of David. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses and his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame and he remembers that we are dust. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for the privilege of worshiping you. God, we know that worship is not something that we came up with. It's not a way that we earn your favor. It's a gift that you have given us. It's a privilege that you call us to, God. So help us to worship you faithfully today. God, as we come together this morning on the heels of July 4th, we thank you for the gift of our country. We thank you for what a blessing it is to live in this country where we can freely worship you, where we can gather each week without fear of persecution. God, that is such a gift, such a blessing. We pray that you would help us to never take that for granted, that we would always be grateful for the blessings that we have to live here in this country. God, as we prepare our hearts for communion later in the service today, God, I pray that you would help us to reflect on what Christ has done for us, that we are able to come here to worship you, that we are able to be made right with you, to be in relationship with you because of what Christ has done on our behalf. So help us as we prepare for communion to examine ourselves, to confess our sin to you, and to rest in the truth and the blessed promise that Christ has forgiven all of our sins through his death on the cross, God. So we pray, most of all, that you would fill us with your spirit this morning as we sing psalms and hear spiritual songs. Pray that you would be with Trey as he prepares to preach your word, and that this would be a service in which you are glorified and your church is strengthened and edified. So in your heavenly name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing together now our opening hymn. I believe it's number 4, To God Be the Glory.
Thank you.
by reminding us that there is more mercy and grace in Christ than there is sin in us. And so we're going to celebrate that truth with our next song, His Mercy Is More. So let's stand and sing together as we celebrate the good news of the gospel and the forgiveness and grace and mercy that we have in Christ.
We pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for your love, your kindness, your mercy. Thank you for your many, many blessings that you bestow upon us. I pray at this time of the service that you would just let us give back a portion of what you have so richly blessed us with. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
And as our deacons bring the plates, we invite you to remain seated, but join us in singing this next hymn, A Christian's Daily Prayer.
Thank you.
As morning dawns, the day awakes, to you I bring my being. O gracious God, my source of strength, in you I live and breathe. Each heart is yours, I was a man. Each deed and pride, my sovereign hands.
I hope the song that we sang during the passing out of the elements during communion really sunk in, because everything that we've been looking at the past couple of weeks, looking at the advent of Christ, looking at his first coming, for us has a whole different weight to it, has a whole different connotation to it, has a whole different perspective for us living on this side of the cross, because we can read all these passages about how Christ came and was born of a virgin and lived a perfect life. We read all of these things not as the coming, not only as the coming of our salvation, but also in seeing him fulfilling that law, fulfilling those prophecies, creating a way for us to have a relationship with him, and we are looking at his second coming. And so I hope this doesn't just become an opportunity for us to just read stories that are now familiar to us, usually around the holiday season in December. But hopefully this is a great opportunity for us to really dig into the significance of Jesus coming. And it's exciting coming out of spending some time in Isaiah, because we see the fulfillment of all of these prophecies as the Savior comes. So we're going to be in Luke chapter 2, verses 22 through 38. And so just to kind of set up what's happening, last week we left Jesus being born, then the shepherds being told that Jesus was born by the host of angels, and the shepherds being a pretty unlikely group of guys who ended up going to see the King of Kings first. And then that last verse, we see a little bit of housekeeping, a little bit of keeping up with the law there. We see that in the custom laid out in Leviticus chapter 12, verse 3, laying out that on the eighth day, the males would be circumcised. And so we see this, and it's easy to gloss over as, okay, cool, that's just hospital procedure back then. We just got to get through that, and then he can be discharged. But it's important for where we land today, because we pick right back up in Mary and Joseph living that pious, living that devout Jewish lifestyle, keeping God's law as they raise this Son of God. If there is anybody who should be excused from that eighth day ritual, it would be Jesus, right? You would think that the Son of God wouldn't have to have this physical reminder, this physical marker that sets his people apart, right? Jesus is holy and set apart enough, right? But no, Jesus came to fulfill the law so that eventually he would then free us not from the existence of the law entirely, but he would free us from the chains of sin and death because of the inadequacy of the law to save us in and of itself. And so it's this really cool opportunity for us to see a little bit of how Mary and Joseph raised Jesus. As a new parent myself, there are many times when I wish there was a manual how to do it perfectly well, right? Those of you who have been there, done that, bought the t-shirt maybe several times, you have asked that question, man, I wish there was a manual for this. And I think that maybe, I mean, you know, I'm putting words in God's mouth here, so just take it easy. But that's one of the things that is a beautiful thing about the mystery of Jesus' childhood is we don't see a lot of how Mary and Joseph parented him through all of those different stages. We know he lived without sin, but we don't get a lot of pictures other than this trip to the temple and then a later trip to the temple. And what these instances tell us is that raising Jesus to follow the law that God laid down, to follow God's law, was an important priority for them. And so we see this foundation being laid when Jesus was only weeks old. And so that is where we pick up in verse 22 of chapter 2. So read with me. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now, if any of you are experts in Levitical law, is in chapter 12 of Leviticus, when this sacrifice is laid out for people to practice, for the woman to go and be purified after giving birth. Joseph would have also had to be purified in this case because he was an active participant in the birth process. They all needed to go be purified in the temple, and so they needed to make a sacrifice. The first option for this sacrifice was a lamb, but there was another option given to people who might not have the financial means to bring a lamb. This was commonly referred to as the poor man's offering or the poor man's sacrifice. So we see Joseph and Mary bringing not the standard lamb, but the poor man's option. So we see Jesus not only being raised in the admonition and the love for the Lord and his law, but we also see him not raised in any sort of earthly means that we would applaud, right? He was of humble origins, but those humble origins did not prevent his parents from practicing obediently the law that the Lord laid out. And so this is very significant because Jesus, when he offers us the opportunity to receive his sacrifice, it is not dependent on what we bring to the table. In fact, all of what we bring to the table would be poorer than the poor man's sacrifice. What we bring would be inadequate for what he requires. And so from 8 weeks old, Jesus is and his parents are teaching us about what Jesus came to do. Ultimately, he would be the lamb that we all needed, but that we were unable to bring of our own accord. And so we see them following the letter of the law given to Moses, but we also see glimpses of the new covenant that he would make with us. We also see this pattern developing early in Jesus' ministry. He's already ministering to us, even though he's only 8 weeks old. We see a pattern of God using unlikely people to accomplish his plans and his purposes. We see Joseph and Mary earlier in Luke. We see them as young, unlikely people for God to use for his purposes and his plans. We see the shepherds who would be on the outcast of their society. Not only would they be young, but they would also not be people whose testimony would normally be listened to. God uses them to be his first witnesses, sharing the gospel, sharing the good news. Their testimony might not be accepted in a court of law in their day and age, but their testimony was the first testimony as to the coming of Christ. Now, it would be easy to stop right there and say, cool, well, God uses unlikely young people for the purposes of his glory. And that's the beauty of this part of the story, is that not only do they go to the temple to follow God's law to the letter, but they also come across two elder saints who have been living righteously for God. And we pick up in verse 25. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up into his arms and blessed God and said, and we'll just pause right there. This is one of the few accounts that we have of anybody picking up the Christ child. So just think about that honor. I wasn't ready for the competitive atmosphere as a young parent that occurs when a baby is born. Other people are keeping tally of how many times they have gotten to hold the new addition into it, especially if you have out-of-town relatives, right? I've made the trip, so I deserve at least 15 holds between now and the time I leave, right? Holding a newborn child is an honor, right? But I feel like that flips on its head even more so when you're talking about the Christ child. That's just a little aside there. Verse 29, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin. And then as a widow until she was 84, she did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer day and night. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. And so we see these unremarkable people from Mary and Joseph to the shepherds to now two righteous and devout saints who have stayed faithful for Simeon. We're not really given as much of a glimpse into his age, but for Anna, we know she is at least 84, probably older, who have practiced righteously God's law, but not in a way that is legalism. We see her devoting herself to fasting and to prayer. And so any of you who have lived any amount of life know that once you live a certain amount of life, life comes with suffering. Life comes with hardships. Life comes with ups and downs. And they are of an age where we don't know what they are. We don't get their full testimonies. We don't get their full stories. But we know, based on the fact that they are advanced in years, they have experienced the suffering that this world has to offer. And in spite of that, what is of note here is that they were both righteous and they were devout. And they were devoting themselves to prayer. And so they put themselves in a posture that is ready to receive the coming of Jesus. We see with Simeon, he is waiting for the consolation of Israel. Now, this is a word that we're going to kind of focus in on, so I kind of want to take an opportunity to define the word consolation. The word in modern dictionaries is defined as a person or thing providing comfort to a person who has suffered. The original word in this text translates literally as calling near or a summons, especially for help. And then later in the New Testament, we see this word used most often talking about the word encouragement or exhortation. Now, any human language usually falls short of capturing the fullness of God and his plan and who he is. But words like this and multifaceted definitions like this help us to at least get a better grasp of what we are looking at. So we don't know a lot about Simeon and Anna's backstory, but what we do know is that they are waiting expectantly. Their waiting is not characterized by taking a long nap and waiting until the trip is over, which is usually my road trip strategy if I'm not driving, is I like to get in the passenger seat, make that nap happen, you wake up and you're at whatever destination you are headed to. It worked like magic when I was a kid. That was not how they waited. It was not a passive waiting. They were actively expecting the Savior to come. And so they model for us what active expectation looks like. And so if you've spent time around somebody who is walking with the Lord for a long time, there is a familiarity with God, with his truth. Not in this ambiguous, spiritual, like vague spiritual sense, but a familiarity with his word, and then a discernment and wisdom and attunement to the Spirit when it moves. You learn as you walk with the Lord through periods of drought or famine, you learn about his presence in a new way that you would not have learned if you were always spending time in feast. But you also need to learn how to walk with the Lord well in times of abundance, in times of plenty. And so as you walk with the Lord through many different seasons of life, you learn more about God's character. God is not the one changing. Our circumstances change a lot, but God is the constant one here. And so we see Simeon and Anna remaining faithful throughout these ebbs and flows throughout their life. They are still walking in close relationship with God and with his word. And Simeon is not just unique in the opportunity that he has to hold Jesus, right? He is also unique because he was told by the Holy Spirit that he would not die until he saw the Christ child. So we know he has to be pretty advanced in years when the next big thing that will happen is he will die. So he is looking at death but he is waiting expectantly and with joy and with hope. Not hope like what the world gives. Not I hope it doesn't rain today. But I have assurance in the hope that God will do what he says he will do. And with Anna, she has not left the temple day or night. She has fasted. She has prayed. She has spent time in the scriptures, and she has been encouraging others who were around as to the coming of a future Savior. She wasn't just devoting herself to the scriptures and holding on to it herself. Her lifestyle oozed. It was overflowing with the truth of God's word. Now, these are both pictures of really not very flashy stories. They're not very flashy testimonies. They're probably not the person who gets invited to share their testimony at some sort of flashy event. But we know that Anna has undergone loss. We know that she is a widow. We know that she has experienced that deep heartache and that she has lived her life as a widow for a long time while still remaining faithful to fast and pray. And we, on this side of the cross, we have evidence in Philippians chapter 1 that the good work that God begins in us, he will see through to completion on the day of Christ Jesus. That's not right now. That is the day of Christ Jesus. So we know that in the midst of pain, in the midst of heartache, God is always working in a not yet but in eternity mentality as we shift our perspective onto him. Now, I feel like my toes got stepped on a little bit when Simeon and Anna were living their lives very devoutly, reading the scripture, and my toes were stepped on personally because I'm sure this is just me, not y'all. But, you know, sometimes when you spend a lot of time in one book, I'm sure this didn't happen to you when we were reading through Isaiah, that not one of you thought, man, when are we going to finish this, you know? We're just reading part of it, but, you know, we could get done at some point. I'm sure that only ever happens to me. The Leviticus part of a Bible reading plan always seems to be the longest part of the plan. But we see here, we see Simeon and we see Anna meditating on these words. So that when Simeon encourages Mary, it goes beyond, what a cute baby you have. I'm sure he will do great things. When Simeon speaks a word of encouragement over Jesus, it's not your typical words of encouragement over a newborn child. He will pierce through the hearts and expose the thoughts of many. He will see the rise and he will see the fall of many. There will be a bittersweet aspect to your parenting of him. A sword will pierce you through the heart. Now, we have a little bit more of clarity of probably what he is referring to, knowing that she will have to see her son hanging on a cross. But in that moment, as a parent, she was amazed at everything that Simeon said to her. Not because all of it was the most uplifting, but because she knew, she could tell, he was immersed in God's word and what he was speaking. The encouragement that he was speaking over her was from God's word. So he knew the scriptures. He was quoting Isaiah as he spoke over Mary. Now, let's go back to this word consolation. Simeon is waiting for this consolation of Israel, right? This idea of comfort, right? When we think about consoling, we all like, okay, that's a very positive sounding word. But consolation, there is an aspect of giving and there is an aspect of receiving. And if you are not ready to receive consolation, it does not do the work it was intended to do. I have learned this most recently. Our daughter AJ, she's probably watching this, so great job. She's 4, going on 12, you know, terrible twos have just been a couple of years long. And when she pitches a fit, the rational approach doesn't seem to work. Her her ability to reason doesn't kick in as quickly as I would like it to. Me putting her suffering into perspective for some reason is not comforting to her. When her lid is flipped, let's use hunger as an example. Hunger has flipped the lid. They are beside themselves. What are you doing coming in here offering me food? That is such a rational way to solve my problem. I don't want food. I need to be irrationally upset for a very long time. However, there's always a come down moment. And when she's able to think for a second, we'll sometimes hear, "Daddy or Mommy, I think I'd like some food. And in that moment, I have a choice. I can flip my lid and say, that's what I was offering you this whole time. Or I can give her what she really needs. When she's upset, when she's in that lid-flipped posture, she's not ready to receive the consolation that I have for her. Right? She is in need of taking a breath and realizing there is a problem that can be solved and there is a solution that can come in. We are reminded many times in the New Testament that the things of the Spirit, that the things of God are foolishness for those who are outside of Christ, for those who do not have a relationship with Christ, for those who do not have the Holy Spirit living inside of them, the things of God sound like foolishness to us. And so this idea of consolation, while to those of us in Christ, we see the peace that surpasses understanding, we see the Savior who can save all, we see the King who is above all kings, and for those of us in Christ, that makes sense. But for those who are not in Christ, it sounds like foolishness. And so when we hear Simeon talking about the consolation of Israel, this was not a man who was looking for a superficial, political, band-aid fix for the people of Israel. We see that the Spirit of the Lord is with Simeon, and we see him discerning that the Savior of the world is there because of his abiding with God. We get early pictures of what it looks like to abide with the Spirit before Acts chapter 2. Our flesh, our gut instinct is usually to hide from the light when we're in trouble. We see that early on with Adam and Eve. We see them hiding from God. We don't see them seeking comfort. We don't see them seeking consolation. We don't see them seeking healing. We see them running and hiding from the only person who can solve and fix and heal the shame and the guilt that they are feeling. The sin problem that they now have, God is the only one who can fix, and he is the only one who they are hiding from. Simeon is walking obediently with the Lord, reading his word, knowing there is a big problem. And Jesus is the only one who can fix it. And so Jesus, as a baby, is in a spiritually blind world, coming into the temple, following the law. But thank goodness that even though we were lost in our sin, We were spiritually blind, and while we were still in our sin, Christ came, was born in a stable, suffered the indignity of laying in a manger, eventually had to travel back, walked through every practice of the law that he didn't have to, but that he chose to, so that he could redeem us. Thank goodness that Jesus flipped the script on everything. He did not flip the script to model for us a better way to keep the law. He did not come to keep the law so that we could say, oh, that's how you do it. Great, thank you. He came to free us from the chains that sin and death brought us. So we see Simeon and we see Anna waiting in active expectation for their consolation. We see them ready when Jesus walks in to recognize who he is because of their active waiting. They've been spending time, they know what the Christ child will look like. They are in tune when Jesus walks in with his parents. They know who he is. Don't miss the work that God is doing because we are not abiding in his word. Active expectation makes us actively ready. And then, moving on, we see active expectation ends up being a posture for us. It ends up being a long-term opportunity for us to maintain that posture of readiness for the revelation of God. Whether that's through his word, for Simeon and Anna, it was seeing the advent of Christ. They're ready to see with their spiritual eyes, as the book of Ephesians says, open the eyes of my heart. Your spiritual eyes were once blinded in your sin, and they are open because of the work of the Spirit in their lives. It is not the fact that they spent so much time at the temple in and of itself. It is not because they memorized globs and globs of Scripture. It is the work of the Spirit in their lives through those things that gave them the eyes to see when Jesus walked in. There were a lot of other devout Jews in that same temple at that same time who missed it. But when he showed up, Simeon and Anna recognized him because of their posture of readiness. Because of their active expectation. Jesus says in Matthew 25, he compares his second coming to that of a thief in the night and to that of a bridegroom coming unexpectedly, and half of the women who have candles there are not ready. They did not bring enough oil for their lights to stay lit. And so those who were ready, the bridegroom takes on, and those who are not ready are not able to come into the feast. We see that when Jesus came the first time, some were ready and some were not. And it is not any work that we do in and of ourselves to be ready. This active expectation comes from our abiding deeply in God's word. Jesus later describes this tension that we have. If you're in Christ, you probably experience this, where your spirit knows what is right. Your spirit desires what is right and what is good and what is obedient. But your flesh is weak. Jesus was praying in the garden before his crucifixion. His three closest friends were sitting there waiting on him. And they fell asleep for one moment. And then another moment, their spirit was willing, but their flesh was weak. Simeon and Anna are not models for how to behaviorally fix ourselves to be ready for salvation. They are models for what it looks like when the Spirit does such a radical work in your life that your behavior just looks like that of a follower of Jesus. There are behaviors involved, but that is not what saves us. Jesus knows our flesh will fail. I'm not sure cognitively how much he was there when Simeon and Anna were talking to them. I'm not sure how all that worked. I'm assuming it's not like a Benjamin Button situation where he is fully aware, but he is in the form of a baby. I think he got the full experience there. But he did not come to fulfill the law in order to condemn the world, because if he did, we would all be in deep trouble. He did not come to say, now y'all try harder. Now that you've seen it once, you can do it again. He came to free us from that. The work of waiting is not passive, it's active. Active expectation. We actively expect and hope confidently that God will do what he says he will do. We don't we don't have to wait for Jesus to reveal himself. He already did it. So if you're waiting for this new form of revelation that will come and give us a new form of God's word, he will come back, he will reveal himself, he will come and take us to be with him in heaven. But he has already revealed himself to us not only in the flesh but also through his word. So we have those accounts. There's no more waiting for us for God to reveal himself. It's already happened. But as Christians, we are confident that he said he will come back, and he will. But in the meantime, the revelation that comes through God's word is in our hands. He came to fulfill the law, to reveal himself to us, and he gave us the gift of his word and the gift of his spirit. And so Simeon and Anna were practicing this before Jesus told us to do it. They knew he was coming, but they also knew that in the meantime there was work to be done. Anna was not sitting there reading, right? She was sharing with the other people there that the hope of Jesus was coming. She was going at her regularly scheduled time to encourage everybody that Jesus was coming. He just happened to be there that time. And so it wasn't her work that made him come. God is sovereign. She was pointing to him the whole time. And so a question for all of us in here, whether you are in Christ or not, is the consolation of Israel consolation for you? Are you receiving the consolation of Israel, or are you seeking consolation in any other thing that the world can offer? Are you still living in spiritual blindness and blind to your sin and blind to the work of the Spirit in your life? Or have you repented of your sins and believed the gospel so that this consolation that came for Israel but was for everyone can do the work in your life? Is that work of Jesus in your life? Does that culminate itself every week? Right now, this right here is the culmination. Just the showing up and the checking of the box, and we're here. We did it. That's it. Or is the work that happens as we worship together, as we open God's word together, is that evidence and fruit that you can see in your life? And so as we had a time of confession, heading into communion, that attitude of being aware and confessing and surrendering these things that we seek consolation outside of Christ is an opportunity that we have each and every day, each and every hour. Christ's love, Christ's work is not meant to make us live in this cycle of sin and shame. It is meant to show us who Jesus is, which makes us even more aware of our sin, which makes us even more aware of his grace and his mercy, which is more than our sin. And so as we walk in that light, as we walk in confidence in those things, how does that play itself out in our lives every single day? Are we living in the light of the consolation, or are we checking the boxes of things that we have to do to make it through to the next week? Simeon and Anna were living their whole lives waiting expectantly for the coming of the king. As Christians, we're doing the same thing. And in the meantime, there is work that needs to be done. Let's pray. God, we thank you just for your word. We thank you for your truth. We thank you for the coming of your son. We thank you for the promise that he will come once again. But God, ultimately, we thank you for the gift that is salvation. We thank you that it is not something that we do in and of ourselves, but it is a gift from you. We thank you for the testimonies of Simeon and Anna, two faithful saints who faithfully served you, who fasted and prayed and told others about you. And God, I pray they would not only just be role models for behavior, but God, as reminders that when your spirit moves, it changes us. It changes our hearts. It opens our eyes and our ears to what you have to show us and to say to us. And so, God, as we wait actively and expectantly for your coming, God, that we would not be caught idle, that we would not be caught asleep, but God, rather that we would be filled with passion and excitement and truth as we declare your name to a lost world. We pray all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing together as we give thanks and praise to God.